morning, everyone. I hope you can all hear me in the back. First of all, I'd like to let everyone know how happy we all are here on the panel to be in Athens with you today. We see so many great friends and colleagues in the room, and it's always great to be here. For those who don't know me, I'm Rob Lustrin. I'm a partner in Seward and Kissel's Capital Markets Group. Our law firm has many clients in the room, as I mentioned, who are here with us today. And we've represented Greek shipping companies and other Greek companies as well, to a certain extent, in all kinds of transactions, from capital markets, private equity, commercial loans, restructurings, and like over the years. And I'd like to thank Nick Bornosis and his entire team for giving us the opportunity to participate in this really tremendous conference. And I think, we do conferences all over the world, and the conference here in Athens is really terrific. As you can just see by the quality of the people on the podium here, as well as in the audience. So just to set the table, as I said, we've been involved in many financing transactions. This is focused on capital markets. I'm closest to the U.S. capital markets, as you can imagine, being stationed in New York. Over the last couple of years, shipping companies have generally struggled to get deals done in the U.S. capital markets due to really a number of factors, which are all pretty well known at this point: oversupply of vessels across virtually all the sectors, poor demand due to slower global economics and trade, little pullback in China that we've seen, and of course, the lower oil prices, which obviously that's debatable as to exactly how that affects all of us, but I think there seems to be a consensus that that has affected things. Commercial banks have agreed to some extensions to give people the runway. We've heard a lot about that over the past year or so, but there are trade-offs there as well in terms of renegotiated covenant packages with the banks. And of course, valuations continue to be stressed, although there have been some increases over the last couple of months. So we've been hearing, again, and I hope the panel will be able to address this, we've been hearing that only the biggest companies with the best credit could get deals done in the capital markets, and that consolidation was really a stepping stone to kind of getting in there. And without any data to really back this up, I would say that my sense, after doing this for so many years, is that things are changing pretty quickly over the last couple of months. We've seen a number of deals starting to get done again: follow-on equity offerings, convertible bond transactions, of which there's been a couple announced very recently, preferred stock deals, a SPAC or two getting done in the shipping market. And the lawyers are busy, we're busy, so we want to hear what the bankers have to say about that as well. And I'm extremely optimistic about the capital raising opportunities, both in the U.S. capital markets and in overseas capital markets. Maybe even a new a round of IPOs might be ahead of us. I turned on the news today and I saw something very interesting about we heard this in a previous panel about the relaxation of regulation in the U.S. unleashing Wall Street and this kind of thing. So I think that really may be helpful. And we have a panel of great experts here who are here to give us their own views of what's going on in the markets today and where they see opportunities for shipping companies and our industry, and what an owner might need to do to take advantage of those opportunities. So let me introduce them to you. First of all, I guess I'll go to Todd Wilson, who's to my left, is Senior Vice President and the head of the Maritime Finance Group at Jefferies. As you know, Jefferies has been involved in shipping for so many years. I mean, as long as I've been involved, there's been someone at Jefferies doing things. So welcome, Todd. Karl Fredrik Staubo of Clarksons, Platou Securities, who, of course, great perspective, having the Clarksons brokerage and research facilities to back up their investment banking side of things. So welcome, Karl. Larry Glassberg, Managing Director at Maxim Group. They specialize in really uniquely tailored transactions in the capital markets, and are leaders in SPACs as well, and have been historically. So Maybe we'll hear a little bit about that. And finally, of course, Isabella Schidrich, who we all know very well, Senior Managing Director of NASDAQ, who is a great friend to the shipping industry. And NASDAQ has led the way with so many new listings and IPOs for our industry that it's really great to have her here and have her perspective on what's going on in the marketplace. I'm happy to say that all of us here have a the firms here really have a demonstrated commitment to the shipping industry here in Greece and other places for a long time, and this group has perspective on what's going on, so let's get straight to the discussion. I think the first point I wanted to touch on is just each panelist's views on the general state of the capital markets, probably with a focus on U.S., and why don't we have maybe Todd, if you want to kick it off, and then we'll kind of go around the table.
Sure. I don't need to tell everyone the U.S. capital markets are ripping right now, right? I mean, you have stock indices at all-time highs. You have debt markets, trading at all-time highs as well, meaning yields are low. The Trump administration, for whatever it will do or will accomplish, I think the markets right now are pricing in, some economic growth within the U.S. And as far as, directly relating to shipping, I think you've seen, as Rob mentioned, some activity in the shipping markets, mostly follow-ons, some convertible bond offerings. Investors are not, scared of the end of shipping, if you will, as we talked about a lot in 2016 and whether investors will come back. I think investors will come back, have come back, and will even come back for IPOs, as Rob said. I think, the IPO market early in 2017 has recovered from, the abysmal 2016 overall, and you've even seen some, solid industrial IPOs early on in the year, including a mining company, a coal mining company. So I think, I think there is some optimism in the capital markets, but I still think there are a few things that need to fall in place before it will really make a difference from an IPO perspective for shipping.
Thanks, Han. Maybe we'll go to Karl next, who can tell us a little bit about what's going on, both from his perspective in the U.S. and also in some other markets where your firm has a great toehold.
Yeah, sure. So we definitely agree to Todd's summary of where the indices are and that we are now at all-time highs in terms of indices, stock market indices, and we see a tightening of high-yield spreads. Translating that into shipping, the most active shipping segment over the last, I guess, year and a half for capital markets activity has been dry bulk. But we have seen a very significant change in the underlying sentiment. Through second half of 15 and throughout 16, the only focus for the capital raisings was runway and making sure that the companies would be sustainable for soft rates for another 2 to 3 years. However, in Q4 last year, we saw the first, call it new startup dry bulk company being Sunga Bulk in Norway. We raised $74 million for Sunga Bulk back in November. The focus for the equity raise was an all equity structure with a low break even and obviously being able to create positive cash flow yields ahead of your competition. When we did the offering in November, the offering was pretty much taken up by Norwegian investor. The focus was obviously debt-free and a low-cost structure. We were back in the market for the same company now in January, so it's been 3 months. We just raised $100 million for them last week. The only focus for investor is how much leverage can you get? We want a multiplication effect, and now we want risk on. At the same time, back in November, it was only Norwegian investors. Now half of the book was taken up by international investors. And that says a lot about the sentiment amongst institutional investors, both on both sides of the ocean, where you have the Americans now way more positive than they were last year. It's focus on the upside, and there seems to be a general consensus that we are going to see dry bulk recovery over the next 2 to 3 years. So that in itself has been an interesting sentiment. At the same time, you have seen the other publicly established companies basically seeing stock prices double since November, with all, you know, all the companies, Scorpio, Eagle, Starbolt, Golden Ocean, all of them have more or less are up between 60 and 100% over the same time period. So we definitely see a lot more optimism. We see the only two segments on our numbers that are trading below steel value is containers and LPG. But you know, obviously values are at the low levels, but tankers, dry and LNG are all trading above steel, showing that there's underlying optimism in all three markets. And at the end of the day, we think this boils down to the fact that order books more or less across the board are at a fairly low level. And there is no equity money for new builds at the moment. And for us and for the industry, we think that's a very good thing. So obviously we'd like to keep it like that until we see actual recovery and not just an expected recovery.
Thank you, Karl. Larry, hey.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks. Glad to be here. I would say, along with my panelists, we've been very active across the board from a firm perspective in virtually every single sector that we're focusing on, whether it's healthcare technology, energy industrials, infrastructure, as well as shipping. In the last year, we've been very active with the shipping market in particular. We've done 7 transactions, 6 of which were book run transactions, and I think 5 of those were actually sole managed transactions. I share the same sentiment. Dry bulk market seems to be a significant amount of appetite coming back into the market today. We had done a transaction about a month ago for a publicly listed company in the United States, raised them approximately $17 to $18 million. About 30 to 40% of that transaction was in retail hands, and the rest were in investors that came into the dry bulk space. A number of those investors had historically invested, but the majority of those investors on the institutional side were new investors within the shipping market. Our view from a firm perspective right now is you're seeing a lot of the convergence from energy industrials and infrastructure players starting to see the market is starting to uptick within the shipping market, in particular on the dry bulk side. In terms of other sectors that are out there, I think it's very story specific and views to where rates are going to go in that specific vertical. But as a whole, the amount of inbound calls that we're getting from both institutional accounts, retail, as well as companies is significant in the market today, because I think people are starting to see that there's a window for potentially getting out of the market. I tend to agree with my colleagues that are on the panel with me today, is I don't think we're quite there yet in terms of new IPOs that are coming into the market. I think we need a little more runway in the market, seeing from a general market perspective, not only from the shipping market, that the market's gonna hold. So the general IPO market is not extremely strong right now. Deals are getting off, and I think as more deals start to get out, and there's a little bit more, let's call it, views that the shipping market is gonna continue with a run, that's when you're gonna start seeing IPOs coming out. Now, with that being said is, I think you'll also start to see alternative products potentially leading the way, i.e. SPACs bringing potential shipping companies into the market. And I think the dynamic with a SPAC versus non-SPACs is that pricing is already set before you get to the market. So there's a little more flexibility to potentially get deals done in the market. And I think that you're potentially going to see a wave of de-SPACings in the market over the next year that potentially could lead the path for the IPO market.
Thank you, Larry. Isabella, perhaps you can touch on more from the 30,000 foot view, what you see over at NASDAQ as an overall loss, and also the platform that NASDAQ can provide to folks in the audience who might want to come to the market.
Thank you very much. I think it has been pretty much covered by the panelists already, including the view. But maybe just to give an overview, we have seen 16 IPOs in the US to date, raising about $5 billion in market cap. We are encouraged by the performance of the IPOs last year, which returned 22%, and the sentiment actually should spill over into 2017. The technology companies performed extremely well last year, returning 40%. And we see with the 80 filers, we have we have seen, which might be the SSE to date, quite a number of tech companies, and these are the large market cap tech companies everybody is watching out for, including Snapchat. So these companies will encourage and further, if the price will, heat up the market. And so we hope for these technology deals. But obviously, we embrace shipping. We were encouraged by the two SPAC companies coming to the market last year, and we hope that more of these deals come to the market. It probably is more challenging for shipping IPOs to come simply because of valuations. So what the US market is always looking for is the growth story, growth equity story of companies. Then obviously investors are buying into the growth equity story and the markets. So what we see right now, the market sentiment is positive, and it was already mentioned at the panel, with the indices being at an all-time high, the Dow Jones and S&P 500 and Russell 2000. We haven't seen these high performances for a year now. So the market sentiment is here, but the growth story of the company seems to be there. The performance of the company, and then obviously investors will buy in. And investors do tend to buy in if you know the belief in the story of the company, obviously the track record of the management of these various IPOs which are lined up.
Thank you, Isabella. The next question I really like to pose to the panel has to do with the interplay between the U.S. capital markets and other markets around the world. We've seen a couple of dual-listed companies, you know, such as Euronav and others, that have successfully traded actively in more than one marketplace. There was a spate of companies that started their life in the public markets in the Norway market, Norway OTC, and also on the Oslo Stock Exchange, that were able to migrate their listings to the U.S. either
on NASDAQ or the New York Stock Exchange. And I just want to see if the panelists had any view on what they feel the future will bring. Are companies going to try to concentrate more on coming straight into the U.S., or do we see some foreign markets as stepping stones into the U.S.? Whoever wants to pick that up.
I can start it off. So the way we view it, there are two exchanges for shipping, and it's the Norwegian market and it's the US market, whether it's New York Stock Exchange or NASDAQ. The way we see it, and the Norwegian OTC market is a very flexible platform to access institutional money and still tick the liquidity box. However, it's not a long-term platform or a long-term place to be listed. It is a stepping stone to capture a growth opportunity. And what you typically see at the very bottom of basically any shipping or offshore cycle is that you see a lot of risk capital out of Norway. Like, for example, for the Songabo case that I just mentioned previously. So we do see continued activity on the OTC. But there's always a clear plan to migrate to a more liquid exchange, be it the Oslo Stock Exchange or all the way to New York. I think when a company reaches a sensible market cap, which we find to be at least $500 million, then it makes sense to migrate. Up until that point, we believe that it's more efficient to grow in the Norwegian markets. And we just mentioned, you know, shipping and dry bulk in particular, but if you look at the other activity that's also been done over the course of the last 3 months, we have raised $1.7 billion over the last 3 months as joint lead or sole book runner. And it's been for speculatively buying into OSVs through Standard Drilling. People recognize that the supply market are obviously very distressed, but then again, you get values at 80% of new build parity. We've done three consecutive raises, basically all of them taken up by Norwegian capital. Once that market seems to be somewhat closer to recovery, we expect more institutional, international money to flow into the same names. We did back in, that was also November, we did two Jacobs that was acquired for $65 million. Both of them have a construction price of around $180 million. They are uncontracted, idle, but just looks to be cheap value. That was for a company called Borr Drilling. So again, that was taken up by a lot of institutional money, but again, a concentration on the Nordics. So we think that Oslo and Norway remains a very important hub to raise money at the very bottom of the cycle. The OTC is a very flexible stepping stone in order to cater for that money. But at the end of the day, that's not a long-term listing venue, and you need to migrate to the full listing on the Oslo Stock Exchange or to the New York. It's been a proven path to go through the OTC and then migrate over to New York. You've seen shipping companies like Scorpio Bulkers do it, but you've also seen Frontline, Golden Ocean, Pacific Drilling, Ocean Rig, and many others follow that route. So it's a recognized way of growing at the bottom of the cycle. And we do expect that to continue. Obviously, now that you've seen a falling market for a couple of years, the OTC market has been way calmer than what we saw back in 13 and 14. But with the revival of Borr Drilling, Songa Bulk, and others, we expect that to pick up again. So we definitely are optimistic to activity on the Oslo Stock Exchange. And for us as a firm covering obviously both exchanges and institutional investors globally, it's quite interesting to follow when you see investor demand migrating over time, because at the bottom of the cycle, the Norwegian markets are strong. In the uptick, you see an inflow of UK and US money, and also Asian money is increasingly coming into play, and obviously we cover investors primarily out of Hong Kong and Singapore as well. So. Risk appetite migrates over time, and being able to have a presence in both Norway and the US, but covering institutional money globally, we think is a very strong formula to capture the capital at different points in a shipping cycle.
Thank you, Karl. Now, as we mentioned, this clearly deals getting done. I was just curious, because you mentioned institutional, Larry had mentioned a little bit about retail, and I was wondering, what is the mix today for each? Maybe Todd and Larry can address this. What do you see the mix as between institutional investors, retail investors, private equity funds, hedge funds? Who do you see primarily interested in shipping? And what is their perception? Do they really need to be convinced? Do they see opportunities? So is there some work to do there? Or do we really see a more investing public, let's say, that's ready, willing, and able to drop some money into the shipping industry?
I'll take it. I think there's things to think about in terms of where investors and dollar flows are coming in from a shipping perspective. And I think each one of our firms here are very different in terms of how we source capital and the type of investor bases that we've had. I think from my perspective, there is demand that's coming back into certain sectors within the public markets, both from the institutional side as well from the retail side. And I think a little bit of that is confidence, depending on where the sector you are, that there is going to be upticks in both freight rates as well as underlying asset values for different companies that are out there. I think we have done a transaction recently in the dry bulk space where there was a significant amount of retail participation within that transaction. That was a transaction for Synergy Maritime, and we've raised them close to $40 to $50 million with over the last 6 months, and that's been a blend both of institutional and retail investors. What's interesting to note, I would say, in particular on the dry bulk side, is where historically a lot of retail investors used to gravitate towards companies that had yield and were paying dividends. We're starting to see from the retail base, at least through our distribution channel, that retail investors are seeing that there's potentially the uptick with the underlying asset prices, which will in turn lead to higher stock prices. So there's a little bit of risk on the table from investors today. Both from the institutional account perspective, we're seeing significant amount of demand flowing within to the dry bulk market, and to a certain extent within the tanker market as well. So I think from my perspective, my firm's perspective, we are bullish on most of the sectors that are out there in the market, and that's a function of both the deals that we're doing as well as the amount of inbound calls across the capital stack today. So that's not only equity, equity. That's not only convertibles, that's not only fixed income products, but there is a significant amount of demand that's out in the market. Additionally, I would say is also for more esoteric products like SPACs, there is significant appetite in the market. And I think in particular, the SPAC market makes a lot of sense for a shipping market today, especially in certain verticals where you see an uptick in freight rates as well as asset prices. And that's the ideal time where you want to be doing a SPAC vehicle.
I think from our perspective, right, we deal much more with institutional investors and larger, more liquid companies, right? And so I think that still remains a bit of the challenge as far as IPOs in particular, but is getting a size where investors feel there's real liquidity in the shares. And so, you know, some of the smaller offerings, smaller cap companies, micro cap, I think you are going to have some institutions, but they're going to be more, you know, flip institutions, not long-term holders. And I think everybody in the industry would benefit from bigger companies, obviously, with longer-term holders, because I think we all know, you know, capital needs to be patient in shipping. And so I think we're starting to see more dialogue from folks on the long-only side, if you will. And I think part of that is driven by people saw what they think was the bottom, and we've come up a little from the bottom, right? So, I mean, speaking with some of the owners out there, they say it's hard to buy assets right now in the dry bulk space, meaning there's no real price you can put out there that a seller's willing to take unless it's a distressed play or something like that. So I think, you know, institutional investors are starting to pay attention to that and pricing in, you know, some asset appreciation. And so, again, I think there's a lot more dialogue with institutional investors. As far as an IPO, I think we're still, you know, a few steps away from, you know, a little more solid recovery and a little more price appreciation from the comps as far as people starting to, you know, make back some of the money they may have lost over the last couple of years.
Thank you, Todd. I just a follow-up question to what we've been discussing is really we've heard a little bit about dry bulk, a little bit about tankers. Just wondering, sector specific, how do the investing public in particular in the capital markets view the variety of sectors? Is a diversified company, are we going to see a little bit more of that again, or are we going to stick to kind of the sector specific plays that really the industry seems to have evolved into over the last, let's say, decade? You know, many years ago, we used to see diversified companies that had many different lines of business, whereas now we're seeing, again, the investors looking for that sector-specific play. Do you think we're going to see a move back to a greater degree of diversification?
I mean, I'll take a shot at that. Unless it's in real scale, meaning multi-billion dollars, I don't think so. I think investors will view themselves as, you know, too smart almost to say, you know, I want someone else making the decisions as far as which space to grow in, so they can manage their portfolio across container, tankers, dry, LNG, offshore, whatever it may be. But if you had something of real scale, meaning again, multi-billion dollars, where the stock was very liquid, so you could come in and out of it very easily, I don't see a small diversified shipping company as being attractive to investors.
Yeah, we agree. You know, what's the point of being listed altogether besides providing liquidity for your ownership? It's obviously to try to use your stock as currency and trade above steel, right? So you could do accretive transactions. If you have a diversified fleet, you'll probably have parts of your portfolio dragging prices up and then other parts of the portfolio dragging valuation down, meaning that you're less likely to trade above steel when people are optimistic to certain parts of your portfolio, meaning that you lose out on a lot of the rationale for being public at all. Because, you know, being public has obviously a big cost. Its cost takes a lot of management time. And at the end of the day, it's only worthwhile if you can utilize the benefits. And we think you need to be pure play in order to ever be able to have an accretive currency. But I also agree with Todd that one of the big issues that we see across the shipping board at the moment is that there is very few investable or properly liquid and investable platforms. Obviously, because of where values are from an historical perspective, you add leverage on top of that, you're left with a very slim market cap. So right now, there's not very many big publicly liquid names. And I think a drive towards consolidation that we may or may not see this time around. It's always been the ego issue, I guess, for shipping to have consolidation. But at least there are some ongoing discussions. I guess the most publicly spoken about is DHT and Frontline. At least for the valuation that was issued, it doesn't seem that it will get through as proposed, but it would be beneficial for the capital market side of shipping to see bigger and more liquid entities.
Guess, Larry, you can.
I would just say, to take it a little bit step further, I agree with what the panelists are saying. I think, you know, looking at from why smaller companies should be more sector specific is taking a step further is how an investor or a research analyst is going to look at the sector. It's more challenging to look at a valuation in a smaller company if you have a diversified fleet. It's very challenging to look at comps. It's very challenging to look at asset prices as a whole versus looking at specifically at the market today. The only thing I would say is slightly different, and I think each firm, again, depending on where your pockets of capital is. You know, from my perspective and my firm's perspective, we are of the view that there is a lot of ability to raise capital in a tranche approach where you don't necessarily have to go out and raise $100 or $200 million at every single clip. So the reality is that most shipping companies are microcap to small cap companies that are listed today. And if you look at that type of base, if you're a $300-400 million market cap company and you're only trading a couple million dollars a day, it's gonna be very challenging to go out and raise $200-300 million. So depending on where you are in the life cycle, it might make sense at certain times, depending on where your valuation is, to pick off $25-50 million, opportunistically make acquisitions and continue to grow the fleet in that manner versus just going out and raising huge amounts of capital every single time period.
Isabella, I wonder, do you have any, I don't know whether you have the statistics on the top of your head as to kind of the average size of the deals that come in through NASDAQ, just overall, do you see the enterprises getting bigger? I mean, we've been talking a lot about consolidation and larger enterprises, or are we seeing things just kind of...
Yeah, no. If I look across the markets now, last year, the average raise was $100 million US dollars. For around 133 IPOs, raising a total of $22 billion. But it has been mentioned earlier on that 2016 was not the best IPO year if I compare it with the six previous years, where we had, you know, around 200 IPOs only the prior year, raising $33 billion US dollars. So the raise was lowered simply because of the large number of biotech deals coming to the market. So we had seen around 40 biotech companies, and they didn't perform as well last year as the previous years. So they were actually sponsored by insiders mainly. In terms of market cap, it has been pretty stable over the years in the U.S. that the majority of the companies coming to the market were in the between the 100 and 500 million market cap.
Thanks, that's actually quite interesting.
But can I only say something to, earlier on we talked about dual listings and OTC, nor Oslo has been stressed as a stepping stone to, which is perfectly valid and it can be, give a good price tag to the company and then a US listing can be a good way to further grow the company and obviously tap in additional US investors, because whatever we see with dual listed companies on our markets, then they add 75% of the investor base is then US domestic, which obviously helps to further grow the company. But just to mention it, maybe this might be the best kept secret in the room and with my fellow panelists here, that we have seen a renaissance in our Nordic markets. So NASDAQ runs the Nordic exchanges. We have the leading exchange here is the Swedish market. And we managed actually to raise over the last 2 years more capital than any other European market. And we have seen more companies listing there. So only last year we had 80 companies raising $7.2 billion, and then the prior year 100 IPOs or new listings raising a similar amount. So if a company is looking at an alternative to Oslo OTC, then First North, which is our growth market there, could be a good alternative, just to mention.
Thank you, Isabella. Well, just to tie things up, I'd like to thank the panelists, who I think did a fantastic job here today. And as I mentioned earlier, I'm very optimistic about this year and what's going to happen in the U.S. capital markets in particular. Just like the weather here in Greece, it was very cold yesterday, and it's a little chilly today. And tomorrow, it's supposed to be nice and warm. So I think I say the same for the capital markets. If anyone has any questions from the audience, we can take them now. And thank you again for your attention.